That's really beautiful. That's a perfect picture, too, because of tonight we're going to talk about how to come into the throne of grace and the passageway, which you know is Jesus, but all a few new understandings of practical, allowing the Word of God to shift a heart from one place to a new place. Because if the heart changes, everything changes, right? A friend of mine, Larry Napier, said it's impossible for us to be anywhere present other than where our heart is. So no matter where you want to be, you're going to be where your heart is. Your heart will override where you mind or your intent or your effort will try to get you. So it's important that we get our heart. So I want to read, and because this is growing, and I'm going to show you two psalms that are really sweet psalms that are practicing as we become a mansion. It means we become, in John 14, a place that the Father and Jesus dwell, because the mansions that God made was for our hearts to be his home. And it comes with presence, and it comes inside promise, and it comes with his power. But in all of that, learning to enter in through his word is probably the richest and least tapped resource. Because everything that we see right now, everything that's around us, everything that we are aware of, is all going to pass away. But after all that's all passed away, and we're in the change of new heaven, new earth, there's one thing that hasn't changed, and that's the word of God. So the things Jesus spoke, and the words that have been spoken, are places we can allow to totally take over our life and totally trust our life to. So let me show you these two fun Psalm 19, verse 14. Just like a little connecting point to tell you what am I doing? Psalm 19:14. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. To meditate, and this is what we're talking, primarily you use this for yourself, always in your quiet time. My goal is simple. I want you to become so thrilled with enjoying God that it is the highlight of every day, the thing you long to go do, and the thing you can't wait to do the next time, and the thing you miss the most when you can't get there. Because his presence, his promise, his power, himself is so rewarding. It's like, I just got to be back in this place of pleasure and prosperity and grace. So this is really key. The words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable. The way to meditate, to ponder, to understand, to look upon, to peer, to increase in imagery, comes with our mouth. Once God begins to paint a picture, we enter into a vision, we have a dream, we're having a supernatural experience, we don't have to talk. The movie's rolling. But many times when we start to try to have that connection with God, we're starting with totally in fuzz. We can't get the channel. We can't get the connection. We're having trouble. And if it was just that, that would be enough. But instead, we've got our adversary there, and he somehow hijacked the line, and he's put his own tape on and his own VCR. Oh, that's old. He dropped in his own digital imagery in your brain and your heart that says you are a failure, God has forgotten you, and you're never going to make it. And besides that, people don't like you. And if you go into that, then you spend your hour to try to convince yourself that none of that's true. And then you wasted the whole time when none of it is true. But you can't just tell yourself it's not true, because that's like pushing darkness out with just willfulness. You can't. Something's got to take its place. Mouth meditates, heart begins, our mouth speaks, mouth. How heart meditates. Psalm 49, verse 3, Rachel. I love this verse, because if you see, it says, Psalm 49, verse 3. My mouth shall speak wisdom, and the meditation of my heart shall give understanding. So, again, primary source of speaking to open our heart to understanding is the wisdom that God wrote down. And last week we touched on start where your need is. If you're trying to build, plant life to flow, go either to where your need is or your offense is. That's the indication where God wants to either dismantle a bad image and a wrong feeling and a wrong emotion, or where you can't find connectivity with God and hope that rises and faith rises, there's a need. You've got to plant seed. You've got to let the word of God start to find its place. So whether it's the offense and the, that needs to be looked at. There needs to be something happening there, and I'm going to have to place light where whatever that is to erupt, disrupt, and then finally take the place of. Or I have nothing here. I want to bring something of substance and his word. And last week we said, find a place where God is pointing to you your need or your offense, and then commit yourself to meditate, to ponder, to encounter, to exchange, to experience God there every day, at least 5 days a week, and watch what happens in just a couple months. You'll go from bankruptcy to beginning new plants growing, new sense of purpose, new sense of hope. So I want to take you now to Hebrews 3, 4, and 5. We'll go through three chapters. I can't take you through every verse. There's so much here. So I'm going to have to kind of bounce around and encourage you to go search around yourself. You know, the thing about the Bible that's really cool is you're actually able to use it anytime you want. It's not only just for church. And you got to get one on your phone or something so you can access it wherever you are. And then go get a concordance and stick, get it on your phone so you can go find out what a word means. And if you're like me, English challenge, get a dictionary so you can go to the dictionary to find out what the English word that explains the Greek word really means. Or go on Google. I know if you're online, you can Google a word just as fast. But those are my three go-to apps, you know, my Strong's, my Bible, and my Webster dictionary. Because a word is only a word until it begins to communicate to you an experience. And when it becomes an experience, it becomes a transforming power. And all things begin to change. And if you don't demand change externally, then you don't disrupt the process of growth. And eventually, I promise you, anything that's growing inside of you will eventually take over the outside of you. If you're not in a hurry, and if you're not trying to force it to come to a conclusion, you're just in. And the good news is, once we see and once we believe, it is complete in Father's eyes. Righteousness is imputed, justification is communicated, and we can just pretty much enjoy it. And we can live to a degree, as our patriarchs did, that it doesn't even matter if I see it, because I saw it. Abraham died only owning his gravesite. That's the only thing he possessed, even though he was the father of all nations and so forth. But he saw Jesus. According to Jesus' own words, he confessed that Abraham saw him. How did he see him? We saw into the promise. He saw beyond the thing of just, there's Isaac. God wanted me to kill him. He changed his mind. I didn't have to. No, he saw in those encounters, experiences, and the promises that followed each experience that God was speaking to a Messiah. And so when he did not withhold his own son, he understood that God was going to bring forth his son, and that his son would overthrow all the enemies of the gates, and he would begin to take possession of the entire planet. And so he could see, just like David was so advancing from his solitude days as a shepherd boy to overcoming Goliath and all of his public life and ministry, finally got the ark into the city of David, and he's in worship, encounters, and growing and delighting in it, and he sets out to build the Lord the greatest city, the greatest house. And he's told, go for it, by Nathan the prophet. Then God interrupts Nathan and says, nope, he's not to. Tell him not to. Tell him instead, I'm going to build his house. So he gets a yes, a no, I'm going to do it this way. And so he said, okay. And he went, and it says he sat in the presence of God and rehearsed what God had said to him through the prophet. Did you know, every time you hear something tonight in your private quiet time in a prophet, it's to be rehearsed until it becomes yours. It is to be recognized. He wrote it down. We have it in the Bible, so he must have pondered it well. But even though he was told, you can't build a house, that didn't stop him from visiting the house in heaven. So he would go. His Psalms talk about one thing I have desired, and that which will I seek, to dwell in your temple, to inquire in your presence. There was no temple. Don't let the natural world stop you from enjoying the supernatural world that's not in front of you. Amen. There is depth. There is largeness. And now we are a people that are inheriting from in Christ, Christ in us, a kingdom that's coming from within us. And it's not appearing out there. If you watch what's out there, you'll miss what God's doing in here. We want to be a people that just carry a union, communion, joy, delight, satisfaction. Sorry, did the world just fall apart? I didn't notice. I'm sorry. I was overwhelmed with heaven. That's what a vibrant life in Christ is like, because it is an overcoming life. It's overtaking and it dismantles whatever's holding our way. So in Hebrews 3, verse 1, it says, "Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Jesus Christ," or Christ Jesus. So we will see throughout the book of Hebrews, I don't know how many places tonight, that he is our high priest, and he's the high priest of our confession. And our confession will consist of the things that are revealed to us in his word of himself and of us in his word. And so it goes on in verse 6. It says, "But Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house we are." So we're the house he's building. We're his house. "If we hold fast the confidence and rejoicing of hope firm to the end." Whenever God speaks, whispers, something goes by, I catch my attention, I find it, I have an encounter. There's a hope, immediate hope, right? Have you ever heard God speak and it was not hopeful? If it was not hopeful, it was not God speaking. He's full of hope. And when that hope alights, we go, and we live again. We're like that wild. That's why I love that song, Wonder. I want to be like that kid, just continually over expectant. But he says the interesting thing is the contest will be to hold that hope all the way to the end. So that tells me what the war is over. Whatever's fighting against you is to take your hope away. 2 or 3 weeks ago on Sunday morning, we had a prophetic word and strong confirmation that God was coming to destroy depression and discouragement and despondency and all of that. Now, that was the invitation of God to journey into a place of liberty. Now, if you then, what that is to mean for us as we mature is that means, okay, God's given me permission to beat depression. He said, it's time, it's no longer going to rule, and I'm going to be free. Yes. And instead of then trying to huff and puff and blow it away, you just go to the Bible. I need to look up joy. And I want to understand freedom and hope, and you start to build in you the truth, because truth will displace a lie, and light will remove darkness, and joy will remove sorrow, and praise will remove despair. And so you're looking into the word, it's impacting you. You're responding to the word, what it's asking of you. You're trying to do what it says before the Lord, not before man, not trying to be a different person. You're just, the beautiful thing is in the presence of God, you get to practice naked. The raw, true you in front of the long, loving, accepting God because of Jesus Christ. And you get to sort out truth and truth in me. Until the truth overtakes the things of me that are true about me but are lies, emotional captivity stuff, and I start to come into a liberty. So chapter 3 tells us, oh man, we're a house, we've been given words, and we have a confession, those are our promises, and we're that house as long as we keep holding that confession, keep that joy, keep that confidence all the way to the end. And then he says, therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, verse 7, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion in the day of trial in the wilderness. Now, we only have a half an hour, so just please, for one half hour, do not tell yourself, that's a good idea, I won't do that. All right, because that's not the way reason he wrote it. He did not write it to warn you not to do it. He wrote it because he's going to deal with us when we do it. In other words, rather than trying not to have a hard heart, I'm going to learn how to unharden my heart. I'll get more mileage with that. Because by now, your heart, my heart, has been hardened many times. Now, hardened heart means simply this. It here's one of those words, indurate, indurate. It means to render stubborn, to make it, you know, just resistant. And we get that way through life. Life does that to us, and we respond in this kind of, no. And we can get that way in a discipline of the Lord, where the Lord said, I want you to stay here. And so then all of a sudden God says, it's time to move. Nope, I'm going to stay here. Because we just kind of say, I want to be autopilot. I don't want to be fussing this. I don't want to be going back in that same problem. And so the heart can get hard very quickly. And he says, here we can see, according to this one little statement of God's, he doesn't get mad often, but when he does, he does. Verse 10, he said, therefore, I was angry with this, angry with that generation. And I said, they always go astray in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So where we depart from God is with our heart. How many times a day do you think you depart from God? I'd say probably 100 times for me at least. Wander away. No, I don't know if I can stand there. I'm afraid. I'm frustrated. My heart wants to go, but I can go. It can easily go a different way. So I swore in my wrath they'll not enter my rest. Now rest is the coolest word in the Bible. It is the whole imagery of coming into the place of campment, of community, of rest, of dwelling, of solace, of completion. And God finished his work after 6 days and then rested. He finished salvation before he started the 6 days of creation with Christ. I mean, so from that point on, he's been in complete and total rest. And so I was teasing Diana, if we're going to be singing about rest, guess what we're going to have to learn? I want to be a house, place of rest. And God say, and okay, cool, you know, be still, peace. And we're going, well, I can't in this situation. He goes, why can't you? That's why it was a beautiful vision. If, you know, the only thing would have been nicer if I was on the back of the boat sleeping on a pillow. Could have dug that. But rest, rest. They don't know my rest. They're not going to enter rest because they're always going astray. And so I swore, made a decision. And so then all of chapter 3 and all of chapter 4 start instructing us how to enter into rest. It comes as a don't, you know, beware of this. But I love the Bible. It's not a Bible of telling me what to do or scolding me for what I didn't do. It's always a way to enter into a connection with Jesus. So when he says, let me see how my time's gone. Verse 14, we have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of confidence and steadfastness of end. And while it is said, today, if you'll hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. That's repeated 3 times in chapter 3 and chapter 4. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. So we know that the reason rest is not available is because of a wandering heart that will not come into unity with God's voice, because it gets hard and it shuts down. And we hear the exhortation, if you hear his voice, or if you are to hear his voice, don't harden your heart. Soften it up. Soften the heart, because it's going to be, the hearing is going to be the initial beginning again, connecting. The awakening. And we were designed to have 6 or 7 connections every day. We were supposed to be walking through the day, just going through with the morning part of our day, but we're looking and listening, and all of a sudden something goes by and catches our thoughts, our emotions, and we go, you know, I think that was the Lord, or at least it reminds me of a scripture. We go there, and all of a sudden, whoa, there is something there. There's something there. I'm going to sit there for a bit. I'm going to rest. Even though you're still having to keep up with your day. And then you go, whoa, that's why you whip out your phone and get your notes and write it down. Or wherever you write, you do something to log an encounter. I had an experience. I don't want to lose it. I want to return to it. Everything you encounter with Jesus that is currently evolving is meant to be watered and nurtured and experienced every day as much as you can. And if it gets so good, you just don't even want to leave everything. You just, oh. But he says, verse 12, beware, brethren. I know I'm going the other direction, but beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. The word unbelief in verse 3 and 4, they're two different words, but they both mean they're not like the disciples' unbelief that when they walked with Jesus. That was kind of like a, you just haven't had an exposure to this yet. This is totally an obstinate, stubborn, I'm not going to be persuaded. Nah. I didn't fall off the turnip truck. You know, I'm not. So the a heart can depart because it gets unbelieving. I don't mean God's departing from me, but I'm departing from the union, the enjoyment. Right? Like I said, I'm not teaching us anything new. I just hope we're going to enjoy it more. Yeah. How you to enjoy God is the chief aim of man, to enjoy him. So he says then, but exhort one another while I was called today, lest you anyone be hardened to the deceitfulness of sin. So we've got so many things moving, so many sights, so many fears, so many conflicts, giants everywhere. So he says, as he finishes chapter 3, that basically what happened is Israel came to the place of inheritance, but they could not enter in because of hardness of heart, which showed up in unbelief and in their rebellion. They just wouldn't go in and face the giants. And so they couldn't hear his voice because their hearts had gotten hard. So they couldn't go forward. So therefore they went backwards and they ended up having this put over them that you're not going to come in. So chapter 4 begins, and I want to get us to verse 12. But chapter 4 starts off by saying, therefore, since a promise remains, how many have promises that are still remaining to be fulfilled? That's any promise still remains of entering his rest. Let us fear lest any of you seem to have come short of it. Short of it is the same as all have sinned and fall short of the glory. It's the same as in Hebrews 12, which says, lest any of us fall short of the grace. So we can fall short of rest, grace, and glory. And it isn't a moral issue. It's a faith issue. You shot your arrow and it just didn't get as far as it needed to get to hit the target. It ran out of gas. It lost its place. So we are being said, don't do that because it's not like a one shot. Somehow we are the arrow, right? We are the arrow, you know, and I don't know how that works, but we're moving intentionally by keeping our eye on Jesus, because as long as Peter saw Jesus on the water, he could walk on the water. When he looked at the storms, he lost his sight. You can't be where your heart isn't. If your heart's set on his face, then you will be where his face is. If your heart gets overwhelmed by the waves, you're going to go where the waves are. And so he says, so indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word, and here's where we're going to start deciding, I can change how I currently am feeling and what I'm currently experiencing with what God is saying. Because here it says, but the word they heard did not profit them. It was not useful. It didn't help. Not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. And the word mix means union and mingle, to make one. Like pouring out of water, it just becomes one. Or what we would say, another English word, be commingle. They didn't take this word they heard and then commingle it with faith. So it didn't profit them. For we who have believed do enter that rest, as he said, so I swore in my wrath, you shall not enter my rest. And so it goes back and forth. Like God just like wants to make a point for about 5 verses. I really mean this. There's a rest. And I want you in it. And you ought to want to get in it. It's the best place you'll ever learn to live. So he goes then and says, verse 10, just as a kind of a picture of why probably a lot of us are in this place we're in. For he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works as God did from his. And the picture of that, the word cease, is the same word for rest. So he's rested from his works as God did from his. Or he has stopped self-striving, self-effort, self-accomplishing as God did from his. He did what he did, and now he could let it be. So we are going to come into a place of not being challenged, threatened, lusting, fearful, pursuing things that we know God is saying, because we will have settled into the rest of God. And that rest is a place where the throne of grace is, where our high priest is, where we are totally, completely open and honest in experiencing God, where his word becomes both our confession of hope and our exposure of self. And it is the most glorious place we'll ever go. So, verse 11. We'll look at this part of the chapter, and then we'll come back to it in a minute. So, let us therefore be diligent. Put every effort. Be earnest. Be intentional to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same ample example of disobedience. As much as I want to believe, I cannot believe what unless I'm believing. You can't make yourself have faith. Faith is an experience that comes from encountering God and hearing his voice. It's something you arrive at, not something you produce. Faith does not come from us, it comes from him. The glorious voice of God, the glorious experience. And so when faith is there, then I can go forward. If faith is not there, I will back off. For the word of God, now here's the key, and I'm going to give you this imagery. You're starting your day in prayer, and you're going to go and you're going to go to a place in the scripture that you currently need God to be real and victorious for you. And that's the place to fellowship, because God loves to meet us at our point of need. And you go to that. No, the first thing that word is going to do is it's going to just prove itself to be itself. It's the boss. It's truth. It's not here to align itself with our opinion or make us feel better about ourselves. It's got one purpose and one purpose only. Truth, light, life. In fact, it's called living. It's called powerful. It's full of energy. It's sharper than a two-edged sword, which is good news. It's opposite of a dull knife. One strike is usually all it needs. So the first thing it's going to encounter, if I'm going to enter into rest, I'm going to have an encounter of something piercing me. Out of God's word, that's locating me first, before it pulls me into God. Does that make sense? The Bible, the reason I will take a chapter and just introduce myself to God in the morning before I try to praise him, even before, because it's just become so powerful to use the Bible to frame my reference, to change my thoughts, to align my emotions, to express who God is, to remember who I am. It's all about you. You're more than able. I'm not, but you are. And it's just like passing through a super duper car wash. The washing of the water of the word. That's all it's right. But here's how it works. It comes like these knives, you know. First thing you do is say, hey, I want to separate what's soul and spirit. Because you don't have a very good clue on that, Steve. You're going around with all these emotions thinking it's spirit. That's just your soul. You have all these opinions and think it's me. I'm not your opinion. I'm God. I don't really care about your opinion. That's soul. But your spirit is alive in me, and there's life that could connect to me. There's an outer man, there's an inner man. Your inner man, spirit man. Your outer man, your flesh man. Your soulish flesh man. Let's separate those two. Let's keep going, and we'll separate joints and marrow. Marrow is the producer of life. Joints is keeping the bones together. Out of the marrow of the bones bring life to the whole thing. Let's find out what is outward, inward, external, internal. If you're going to live with God, he's going to go after what's important to him, and what's important to him is your heart. The only thing that matters is your heart. He judges every decision he makes about us, about timing and a placement, is on our heart. Amen. He looks at our heart, and he goes, well, nah. Or, yeah, well, let's do it. We look at circumstance. Well, can I obey God? Am I in a good health? Do I have the right, have I had the right experiences? Do I have the resources? He doesn't look at any of that. He just looks at one thing, my heart. That's why I let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable. And if I'm meditating with my heart, if I'm allowing this cleansing, purging, light, delightful experience, then soon my heart starts to reflect him. Because he goes on and says, he'll even go to discern the thoughts and intentions of your heart. So, the first passageway, this is why so many people don't enter into rest, is that the word of God's going to catch me. It's going to collect me. Hey, you're really afraid. No, I'm not afraid. I've got faith. You're really angry. No, I'm not angry. Well, then why are you gritting your teeth? Oh, I'm not gritting my teeth. It's your emotions will tell you what your mind won't allow you to think. That's your emotion. You know, here's the good news. If I have I have an emotion that isn't one I want and comparable to what God would have me have. I didn't realize when I started doing it, but I caught myself and I thought, is that okay to pray? And then he said, of course it is. I'd have an emotion and I said, Lord, did you feel that? And I thought, well, that's an odd thing. Did you feel that? And of course he felt that. He's inside of me. And so then I'd go, rather than in my old days of thinking God was only loving me if I was wonderful, I didn't go hide it. I opened it. What is that emotion? Where is its source? What's going on? And there's opportunity. But even that often directs me back to the Word, because what does the Word say? Because out of the separating of me and soul and intentions and thoughts, God starts to imprint to me timeless truth that is mine for eternity. That's my confession of hope. That's my offering to God. That is the most valuable thing you will give God in your quiet time, is his words that he said to you. The words he said to you that you heard, that you know to be what he said, and you recount them back to him. That's your confession of hope. That's your ministry in the presence of God. That is the thing that starts to shift outcomes. But let's just realize why we have to allow honesty. Christians are so dishonest with God. I mean, there's only one being in the universe that can really handle your stinking attitude and your selfish attitude and your anger and your all of that yuck. And it isn't to be twittered. It's to be told to God, the Father, to Jesus. It is to be approached inside of heaven with an honest heart. And so here he says, there's no creature hidden from his sight. Everything is naked and open to the eyes of him whom we must give an account. That is incredible. Let me unpack it for you. First off, God sees everything. Nobody can hide from anything. But indeed, as we appear to him, we're naked. So you're naked when you appear before him. You can see, whatever you're covering, it doesn't work. He sees you. Heart, again, heart mostly. Most important, heart. But it's also to whom we must give an account. To whom we must, literally, is the imagery of an animal about to be slain. So not only are you naked before God, but he's got you by the jugular. You are at his absolute mercy. There is nothing that's going to happen without him. And you and I are learning this trust mechanism. It'd be like, God, are you okay with this? I want to have an intimate relationship with you, Father, and I really want to be a house of rest. He says, fine, come on over here. Let's let my word just go through and don't worry about what's going on. You know, be honest, open, naked. And I got you by the throat anyway. And now breathe. and all you're fearful, I'm going to be just told to get out of here. I'm not to be allowed. I don't have a place. I don't belong. All that judgment, criticism, all that stuff. She starts getting freaking out. Because if he really knows who I am, I'm going to be told to leave. And so he knows what he's doing. And it says, to whom he must give an account. You know what that word is? Logos. We go through the Logos, are having an experience with the Logos. We are naked before God. We are at his mercy. And we will eventually carry a Logos to God. We will carry a sound. We will become a statement. You will be known by what you say. You'll be recognized by promises. If we were to be seen by heaven right now, we'd be seen with promises all over our head. We'd be words that have been spoken that are determining our future, that are our DNA and where we're going. So then he says, so basically I feel pretty much like I just want to honor your word because your word is truth. And whatever it does to me and crosses me, I think I'm going to yield to it, because whatever, it's got the penetrating power, and there's no reason to hide. I'm going to talk honestly in response, and I'm going to sit inside your mercy, and I'm going to know that you are transforming my conversation in this life to your conversation, my words to your words, and we're going to have a great time. But here's the good news. We have a high priest. He passed through the heavens. Jesus, the Son of God. So even though you're going through all that, hold fast your confession. You see, they're not in denial. They are in complete. The confession of what God says to me that awakens my life, that launches me to a journey, it is who he says I am and who he is, most importantly, who he says he is. That I'm supposed to always hold. When I learn about me, that didn't change what he said. But it also, I need to hold that confession, but also don't, we have a high priest who can sympathize with our weaknesses. He was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. So it's like Jesus saying, okay, guys, I really need you to agree with me, because I got the victory and you're not going to get it anywhere else. You've got to learn to agree with me and what I'm saying. And you got to love me what I'm saying. And you got to let what I say irritate you and offend you and hurt you even. But just stay with me, because I also understand how hard that is. I know what it's like to have everything going against you. I know what it's the hostility of sinners feels like. I know when no one will agree and you can't seem to find your way. And I know when it feels the only thing you can try to find is this little voice that says, I love you and I will not forsake you. And everything else is telling you you're lost and you're forsaken. And I know what it is, so I'm going to strengthen you. I'm going to help you. So therefore, let's go together now to the throne of grace. And here we are. My Father sits on the throne of grace. I'm your high priest. I'll bring with your confession that you're giving, and we'll offer it to God. And out of that confession and out of your destiny and out of my inheritance that I've given to you and you and me and me and you, we'll just start releasing all the mercy and the grace you need for this moment. And literally, we stand there in the presence, and we just start saying, Lord, let it be. Bring the transformation. I receive mercy. I receive grace. Now, if my soul has not had mercy in a long time, it's hard for my heart to say, I receive mercy. I receive grace. If my circumstances have been cursing me, it's hard for me to say, I receive mercy. And I just receive grace. But the good news is you're in heaven. You're in a heavenly realm, the Holy of Holies. And soon the environment of heaven will convince you otherwise. Your circumstances will start to fall off because you're standing somewhere that's not of this world. You're standing in the citizenship of heaven. You're standing. And if we, for us to become what God has already made us to be, it will take such transformation that we're not going to get it from the planet. We're not going to get it from our friends. We're not going to get it from our bank account. We're not going to get it from anywhere but him. And he doesn't want to have it some far off. He wants to have this experiential connection. Let me show you how come that is so. And then we'll close it. Jesus becomes the high priest, chosen by God, appointed by God, made a son, made a priest. Verse 7, chapter 5, in the days of his flesh. I love the days of his flesh, because the day Jesus had days of his flesh, I can have days in my flesh. The ones I'm living right now are the days in my flesh. All right? And it's not going to be the easy time. It's going to be the conflicting time. The days of his flesh, he offered up prayers and supplications and vehement cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his godly fear. So there is so much of life that you don't want to be happening, but God's going to hear you as you cry out to him. And though he does not deliver you from what you're asking him to deliver you from, the better thing that comes is you hear his voice. You hear his voice. Honesty, that's Gethsemane, right? That'd have to be the apex of that prayer. Gethsemane, if there's any other way. He's heard, but he's not given his request. Though he was a son, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. The word obedience means to listen under, to hearken. Today, if you hear his voice, don't harden your heart. Though he was a son, he learned obedience. The things he was going through helped him to hear the voice and learn to live under the voice. See, because you're going to go into God's presence and he's going to say, I've got this. And you're going to go, yeah, we've got this. You're going to go back into the circumstances and bam, he doesn't have anything. And you're going to come back and say, God, how? I thought you said you got this. Did you drop it or something? No, I got this. It's forever. It's eternal. We've got it. And it just builds you back up. And you go back out there and it's bam, there's nothing's changed. And then you're going to go back. Are you sure? Do you have the right address? Do you know where my bank is? Do you know where my circumstances are? Can you get there? I got it. We've got this whole thing. We've swallowed it up. Death's gone. The mountain's gone. Everything's gone. Yeah. Bam. There it is again. And either one or two things are going to happen. You're going to say, I don't know. Your soul is going to say, I can't go. I need some concrete right now. And you just kind of back off. It's a little hard to have a relationship with somebody so confident who allows me to get so slaughtered. I don't get that. So you kind of, as I have, and all of us have, we draw back. Must have that wrong. Got something, you know. Or, and usually after many times of drawing back and returning, we start to go, you know, I don't know. I feel good when I'm in his presence. I feel loved. I feel joy. I have strength. I have hope. I am sure I'm hearing him. His word's coming alive. I think I'm just going to stay here. And then when I go into the earth, I'll just anticipate probably nothing's changed. But because nothing, I'm not trying to force change, I'll carry this presence, this experience into the day I'm about to go in. And all of a sudden, you start learning to carry the presence that you're encountering in your quiet time into your busy time. And I believe, I'm a firm believer that Jesus taught us to pray daily. Because you get an access. Once you have access to heaven, you can get it all the time, all the day. It's just simple. But you have to start it up again the next day. It's not that the blood has expired. It isn't that the righteousness of God is no longer working. It's just you expired. We don't know how to. Creation can't carry manna more than a day. It turns into worms. But it's always more the next day. So you were made to live with a quiet time. Yes. You're committing suicide if you don't have a quiet time. Slow death. I'm not getting anything from church. Bible doesn't talk to me anymore. Having a hard time trusting God. Do you really think God's going to sit there and go, everybody, quickly, we've got to rush to Steve. He's about to tell people I'm not nice. He's God, guys. He's God. He thinks he's wonderful. He thinks, come and believe me, guys. Come and get a hold of my strength, and you'll make peace with me. But there's no peace without grabbing his strength, and his strength is Jesus Christ. I gave you my best provision. Grab him again. Invite him again. Engage him again. Get born again, 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 again. Whoa, so good. So having been perfected, having been completed, he became the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him. Learn to listen under his voice. That's us. Hallelujah. You see, if I don't get delivered, I'll hear his voice. And when I learned that, I learned to take advantage of the voice because that was the better prize than the deliverance. Yeah. Right? If Jesus gotten delivered from that cross, then we wouldn't be here tonight. And we wouldn't be his prize. So he got a better thing when he heard the sound of the voice of the Father, and he was given confidence once again that all was well, even if nothing would change in the circumstance he walked through. And that thing kicked. So now, he's called to be high priest, according to the order of Melchizedek, of whom we have much to say. That literally is the word say, is the word where you get lego. Lego. We have a lot of things we want to just lay out, build. So much to give you, so much to say about him. He's got the possibility of relationship in God and with God and through God because of Christ, that high priest, and holding a confession and walking through his word and having an experience and growing in this is so beyond what any of us have even been able to touch. But we can't even talk about the basics because you've become dull of hearing. The word dull literally is where we get the word sluggish. Or lazy, but its root word is where we get the word bastard. Undisciplined, not listening under another voice. doing our own thing, not coming under the voice. As Hebrews 12 will later say, if you do not come under the voice of the Father, then you are not his. So every child will be being brought through the word process. Every one of us is going to be feeling, I need you to believe right now, Steve. I don't want to believe. I need you to believe right now, Steve. I don't want to believe. I need you to get strong, Steve. I don't want to be strong. I need you to get strong. I don't want to be strong. Oh, he stopped talking. Maybe I won. No, I just hardened my heart. Voice got a little duller. Then later I'm crying, help me. I need you to be strong again. Okay, I'll be strong. So for though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach again the elementary, the first principles of the oracles, the first sound of God, and have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness. The word righteousness is an overused English word, and it makes us think we have to be good people. It literally is the word justification. You're not skilled yet. You haven't yet thoroughly convinced yourself that you've been justified by Jesus Christ. So you're running around doing a lot of stupid things, trying to prove yourself that you're not stupid. You're trying to be righteous, which you can never be. So you're building a self-righteous resume that doesn't even matter. So you're circling. But solid food belongs to those, this is my fun part, to those who are full age, matured, complete. That is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Greek. Who by reason of use, who have practiced naked. That's literally what the Greek says. They've been practicing naked. I don't suggest you do that at church. But I do suggest every time you come before God, you're honest. You're not hiding your heart. No cover up. And they've exercised, which means through a habit of practice, they've created a habit, they've built a path, they've established connections, they've become known upon a certain point, so they've got to known in every way, they can discern both the good and evil, which is always possible in everything that we're in. Everything, everything, everything. Christians, they go nutty because they think, oh, we just got into a good thing. Good forever. No. Good till the devil gets you. Right. Till he figures out you're on a good forever path, and he's going to knock you off. Oh, I can't believe this happened. It was so God. Well, of course it happened. You have to get disconnected from self sufficiency, self-confidence, it's because it's God, it has to be good. No, so many things can be bad. Good things happen to bad people, bad things happen to good people, and God is good to everybody. So it's a mixture. But we go back to the pass through the water. Don't try to have a relationship with God without his word, because you don't know truth. But if you were in his word to some point, and I'm not saying reading the Bible, find the place that's talking, but then stay there until you've gotten everything out of there that can be said. And until you experience it, until you begin to imagine it, until you begin to have a framework. This whole thing, I'm walking in. I want to come. I don't want to be out in that desertly life anymore. I want to come into the rest of God. So here I go. Ooh, first thing is this sword spinning. It's like those car washes, you know, but instead of the feather stuff, it's swords. But if I am not fighting it with my soul and saying, no, this can't be true, I won't allow this to happen, I'm not going to think those thoughts, that's not the way God is, I've never known them this way. We just start saying, whatever you said is truth, whatever you said is truth, I magnify you, you are good, you're God. All of a sudden, soul, spirit. Oh, that's soul, that's spirit. Let's go spirit, leave the soul. That'll easier. Let's go into the inner man, not the outer man. Let's go into the heart. Okay, yeah, you're right. There you caught me again. Caught me again. There you go. Caught me again. I thought I had got over that. No, I'm obviously not over that. Had the same thought, same emotion. Okay, wow. And then you're naked. And then you got he's got you just so he knows, he just wants you to know he can kill you tomorrow. Kill you right now, kill you yesterday, but he's not going to kill you. He just wants you to surrender. You know, so think of that. It's like I want you to feel really comfortable while I have you to slay you. But that's the opposite of your flesh. Your flesh is freaking out. It's telling you, do something. If you don't do something, something's going bad's going to happen. You got to stand up for yourself. You got to tell the truth. You got to go do this. You got to get out of here. Leave that place. That's not good. That's never God. The righteous don't make haste. They can stand there and go, what? Why would I go anywhere? Get out of California. It's going to flood. Thank God it's going to flood. I mean, I've been waiting for years for it to flood. But I've lived here all my life. So people have said, earthquake, got to leave. I thought, well, that doesn't make sense. How can I leave just because there's going to be an earthquake? I got to stay here whether there's an earthquake or not. Let's see if I can find God about this. And usually it's all a bunch of fuzzies, externals. And you start getting, he says, I just need you to get a hold of Jesus. Jesus is just beautiful. I mean, he's beautiful. He's more beautiful than the answer to every prayer in this room. More beautiful than the answer of every revival and every move of God yet to come. He himself is everything. And once we behold him naked with our separation going on, but also holding the promises he's given us, we have a confession, something powerful. I'll show you the last verse and we're done. I'm sorry I went too long. I got happy. I got on the boat. Hebrews 13. I just discovered this last year, and it's just amazing. Because I love this verse. Verse 15. Hebrews 13, 15. Therefore, by him, you all know this scripture, let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God. That is, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. So I was just drawn to that verse. And I start popping through the concordance, checking the words, just wanting to have a fresh encounter with the voice. And I come to the giving thanks to his name. It's confess his name. That's crazy. In other words, what seems to be the most powerful sound of praise to God that we are to practice continually, that is maybe indeed a sacrifice to us, but it is indeed what God delights to hear. It is the fruit of our lips, and it's saying and declaring his name. And all that his name means, and all the ways we can enlarge his name and experience his name and describe to him greatness. Because therein is transformation, beholding him. And his name carries everything. And his name has been given by an inheritance. His name has put him in a higher place than angels. It's just humongous. That which is in his name. Let's stand up. You guys have been terrific. Appreciate you. Oh. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray right now because there is such a call from the inner court, from the Holy of Holies, from heaven, to assemble your sons and daughters in your presence, where you are dispensing mercy and grace and shifting outcomes. But Lord, it can overwhelm our hearts when they have been hardened through whatever we've been through, and we've been through a lot. But yet, your word is still the water that washes. It is still the sword that pierces and separates and discerns. It's still where faith comes from. It's still what holds the worlds together by your power. It's by what you created all things. It's how you're bringing forth everything. So we just submit to the word of God. Give us words to walk through, to worship with, to praise you. Give us a scripture. Lord, we're asking this. We're not smart enough to deliver ourselves. Give us a verse, a chapter, a place to go and behold. I have to go now to the waters, the perizim, the water of breakthrough, because that was spoken. And it would just go by if I don't go and linger there and learn what that means and place myself there. So, Lord, let it be for everyone in this room and everyone online that there become right now by the Spirit of God a reminder of what Jesus is saying. And a guiding us into the truth he's declaring and revealing us what he's trying to bring us. And then, Lord, as we are there and it discombobulates our theology, dismantles our own belief systems, challenges us, so what? We stay there, we're naked, You have us, and we're learning your logos. We're going to be brought to give you an account of your word again. But not by our doing, but by our confessing and our high priest. Jesus, walk here. Walk with us. Walk in the midst of us. Walk alongside of us. Talk to us. Teach us how to talk. Teach us how to talk in the presence of Father. Teach us how to hold a confession pleasing to our daddy without dishonesty. Let us be super honest. We're the only place in the world we can tell you that you're good, and we can tell you that we are so mad, and you can handle both. And one does not discount the other. It looses us from what we feel to what is you are truly giving us. And then, Lord God, let there be new exchanges. And as we practice, may we always practice naked. May we not put on religious garbs and arguments and what we think you would want us to think and feel and come to appear before you. But may we come having a practice of habitually coming in the presence of God, with your words of God, with the revelation of God, in the state of our own nakedness, neediness, honesty, and may it be such that you begin to give us the ability to go, hey, that's evil, that's good, let go of this, grab all that, don't take this, take all that, and begin to just be transformed. Lord, may it be for the glory of Father that you would cause us to shine. Make the light that is shining in a dark place right now begin to dawn and rise as a morning star. In the name of Jesus, this week, I declare and decree there will be encounters with Jesus Christ and his word and the throne of grace and exchange and letting go and releasing and picking up and carrying that will literally become so compelling that we'll go back for more. Until that which you have started, you establish, and that which you establish, you have finished and completed, and life comes. We thank you for that now in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Thank you, guys. Sorry for the extra 15 minutes. God bless.